First of all, please forgive my voice. I'm having an allergic reaction to something in this room. I think it's the carpet cleaner. My dad used to run a floor covering business, and I was sensitized to that at a very early age. Why are we all here today? I think we're here simply because there's some politicians who just don't seem to get the message. In the last election, the public tried to send a message that they wanted people to work together in a collegial way and quit the unnecessary partisanship. And when I entered politics, I was taught from day one that anytime you went into an agreement, anytime you went into a negotiation, that in the end you had to make sure the other guy won something too, or else you would have permanent bitterness and nothing that you did one year would hold the next. So you always need to be looking for ways to make everybody feel like they got something out of the arrangement. And yet, that's exactly the opposite of what Governor Walker and his supporters have done. And you know what the litany is. First, they took away workers' bargaining rights. Then they changed the law to make it harder for people to vote. And then what they did was to make sure that if the public did want to retaliate, that it would be ineffective, because they redrew district lines so that the example in Roberta Darling's district, even if she loses the recall election, they've now redrawn the lines in such a way that they think come November, it'll be almost a totally new district, and they think she'll be able to win there. That is an absolute, total disregard for the idea that the people have the last word in a democracy. And yet they've been cynical enough to play that game all over the state, even on the congressional level. What they've done to this county, for instance, moving it from one congressional district to another, just for the convenience of politicians, not for the convenience of the public. And then the thing that they've done that really bothers me is that they've gutted funding for education. Now Walker says, we didn't have a choice because the budget was in such trouble. Baloney. I asked the Legislative Fiscal Bureau in Madison to tell me how tax rates have changed in this state since I left the legislature in 1969. And what they told me was that the bottom tax rate has gone up by 70%, but the tax rate for people at the very top, people making over 210 grand a year, that has gone down by 22%. All Walker would have had to do is to return that top tax bracket to where it was when I left the legislature, and they would have raised $600 million in this biennium. And they would have been able to cut by over two-thirds the hit that they laid on education. So when they tell you they didn't have a choice, that is pure 100% Republican bull gravy. And make sure that people understand that. And make sure they know what they mean by bull gravy. Then, I couldn't help, and I don't want to speak long because what you're doing is a lot more important than any speech. But I was looking at the local newspaper today, looking at the report of the debate between you and your opponent. And it said, Harsdorf has said that she has a long history of working in a bipartisan manner. If that's the case, my question is, why did she stop this year? Don't let them get away. Don't let Luther Olson get away. Don't let Sheila Harsdorf get away with the idea that somehow Walker may be an extremist, but I'm a moderate. The fact is, they supplied the votes. She provided the votes that enabled Walker to do everything that he did. They were the great enablers in that legislature, and all they had to do, if they had any misgivings about what was going on, all they had to do was to vote no or to say, sorry, but you need to reconsider, and you would have had a far different outcome. The second thing that she said, we're taking a different path than our neighbors, Minnesota and Illinois. I think that's true, and I think that's tragic for Wisconsin. And let me tell you why. If you take a look at Wisconsin and compare it in 1970 with today, and if you compare our economic standing with Minnesota's then versus today, here's what you find. You find that in 1970, the per capita income for somebody in Minnesota was about $1,000 higher than it was in Wisconsin. Today, it's almost $4,000 higher. Second, if you take a look what has happened to support for education and for the university, in 1970, 42% of the operating budget for the University of Wisconsin came out of the state treasury. Today, less than 18% does. That's a huge, huge drop. That has generated huge increased costs for the families of any kid who wants to go to college. And then if you take a look at the difference in education levels, in 1970, Minnesota had about 1% more of their population who had graduated from college than was the case in Wisconsin. Today, there's almost a 5% difference in the percentage of the population that has graduated from college. That's a five-fold increase in the gap. So if I were Sheila, I would not be bragging about Wisconsin taking a different path than Minnesota, because Wisconsin systematically, over the last 20 years, has disinvested in the things that will create jobs. It always amazes me that the politicians who talk the loudest about creating jobs are the politicians who do the least to create the conditions to provide for them. They don't support education the way they need to. They don't support job training. They don't support infrastructure. I think it's time they're called on it. This election is not about Democrats or Republicans. It is not about the Democratic Party getting additional seats in the state Senate. What it is about is returning Wisconsin to the values that have defined this state since the days of Bob La Follette. Before Bob La Follette was elected to the governorship, Wisconsin was like any other turkey state in the Union. It was in the pockets of big business, in the pockets of the mining companies, in the pockets of the railroads, in the pockets of the timber interests. And when Bob La Follette came to power, he turned politics right side up and put the average people of this state back in the driver's seat. And you know the laundry list of progressive legislation that was passed, running right on through Gaylord Nelson and Pat Lucey and Warren Knowles. And what I find so sad is that something has happened to the Republican Party in Wisconsin. When I was in the legislature, Warren Knowles was governor. His brother Bob was the leader in the state Senate. They were two reasonable, civilized human beings, and we got a hell of a lot done. We got a hell of a lot done in that 65 session. And the parties competed with each other to see how much we could get done, not how little, as is the case, for instance, in the U.S. Senate today. And now we see just the opposite. When I was in the legislature, we used to actually have lunch with each other across the aisle. We actually had friendships across the aisle, and things got done sometimes on the basis of personal trust. Today, the worst thing about what Walker did and what his supporters did in the legislature is not even what they did, it's how they did it. It is the thuggish way that they went about transforming Wisconsin politics from what used to be a relative area of goodwill, even in the middle of disagreement, to a poisonous atmosphere where there is incredible suspicion between the two parties. And the only way you can change that is by sending a message that you're not going to support the enablers who allowed that to happen. And that's why Sheila ought to go. That's why Luther Olson ought to go. That's why Roberta Darling and some of the others ought to go. And that's why you're here today, because you're as tired as I am of seeing the state needlessly polarized at a time when we needed unity rather than nasty, cynical division. So it's in your hands. And I would remind people, they get what they vote for. In the last election, people were asleep at the switch. People were relaxed. The Democratic Party was far from at its best. And I have to tell you, things have changed. I was over in Rhinelander about 10 days ago at a similar meeting for Jim Holper. And if that meeting had been held in the last election, there might have been 10 or 12 people there. Instead, they had 260 people ready to spend an hour in a training session and then go out and hit the doors for the next week. And that's why Jim Holpern is going to win, because you've got an army of people on his side, and I think that's why you're going to win too, Shelley. I'm done. It's your turn.
thank you, Congressman. As many of you know, I always talk about how I come at this as somebody who's a reader and a researcher, and I read everything I can. If you have not yet read Raising Hell for Justice, Congressman Obie's book, I highly recommend you read it. Because, among other things, he talks a lot about these relationships and the different people that you work with and sitting down and building that's what we need to do. And we've talked about this from the beginning. And when people sit down and talk to each other, when we have that moment to actually converse, we realize we agree on far more than we disagree on. But we've been led astray by the games and this name for something and that name for something and flashy titles that really don't mean anything. And so all I have to say is this. I know the momentum is with us. The movement is with us. You know, because you're feeling it. I know you're feeling it. It feels really good right now to be a part of this. And probably one of my favorite things is this. It's the congressman is here and it's wonderful. We still have so many people outside canvassing that said, you know what, I'd love to see Congressman Obie, but I know I need to knock on these doors. And we know we have so many friends all over the place. We've got similar things going on today, literally everywhere, even up in Grantsburg. We've got people knocking on every door in this district, reminding people, yes, we know it's August, but this vote really, really matters. And it is going to set a tone, not just for us, but for the nation. And we're saying, you know what? This is not what we believe in as our state. This is not what we want to happen. We are about, we deserve more. The last name's merely convenient coincidence, but we do in fact deserve more than what the state has given us right now. And so that's what we're standing for. I know I'm excited. I'm enjoying the phone calls I'm making, because the calls I'm getting to make right now are mostly to people that say, they've called in with a question and they say, you know what? I've always voted for Sheila, or I've always voted Republican, but answer this for me. And I love those phone calls, because you get to say, you know, you listen and then you say, this is what I stand for. This is what we stand for. This is what our movement is about, and this is what we believe in. So I thank you in advance for the next several days of tremendously hard work that I know you're all going to put in, and we're going to put in together, for knocking on those doors and making those phone calls and reminding people to vote, even when they say to you, I get it already. Sometimes they still forget. We all lead busy lives, and you say, I know it's annoying to take this phone call one more time, but that's how important this is. It is that important that we're going to bring it up again. It's like the little kid who tells you every single day for like 3 months before their birthday what they want for their birthday. Well, this is what we want, okay? We're going to keep bringing it up until it shows up, all right? So thank you, thank you, thank you. Let's go knock on those doors and let's bring people together.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.